Welcome back, y'all. In this video, we're following up with a definition of row echelon form as a tool used to solve general linear systems problems. Remember from a previous video that we defined the general linear systems problem as starting with a given matrix, a matrix that arises from a modeling context, and a given right-hand side vector, where the matrix may be rectangular and not square, and the row dimensions of the matrix matches the row dimension of the right-hand side vector. In that situation, we're on our search for the unknown vector x. We also discussed in a previous video that the strategy we're going to use to solve such systems actually follows the same strategy that we used to solve non-singular linear systems problems via Gaussian elimination. In other words, when we get the original problem, we spend weeks or months developing a model, thinking critically, generating the matrix. Then what we're going to do is hit the matrix on the left-hand side with elementary row operations. So those may be shear matrices, dilation matrices, or permutation matrices, aka transposition matrices. We do that enough times, I call it T number of times, to get that matrix equation in special form so that we translate the original matrix into a matrix that is a lot more algebraically beautiful, not as painful to work with. If we hit the left-hand side of an equation with a sequence of matrix multiplications on the left, then we got to do the same thing to the right-hand side of the equation. And so that vector y represents the idea that whatever I do to the matrix A, I must also do to the vector B. When I get this in special form, the main idea is that depending on the structure of my original matrix, the type of form that I'm shooting for may change. If this was a non-singular linear systems problem, the form that we want is upper triangular with non-zero diagonals. For general linear systems problems, we're going to use row echelon form and reduced row echelon form. So the special form that we're going to translate our original matrix into is called row echelon form, or more advanced, reduced row echelon form. You might ask, well, what the heck is row echelon form? What does that look like? That's a great question. Let's define row echelon form for a rectangular matrix U that has m rows and n columns. We say that U is in row echelon form if it satisfies the following three conditions. Number one, all zero rows are below non-zero rows. A zero row is a row that has all zeros. So if all the zero rows come at the bottom of the matrix, that's the first condition that we have. Number two, the column index of the leading entry, the first non-zero entry, is larger than the column index for previous leading entries. This is the classic stair-step property that we're going to see in just a minute. Finally, the third condition is that all entries in a column below a leading entry are zero. So remember that a leading entry is the first non-zero entry when you look in any given row. When you look under that, they should have all be zeros. Let's go ahead and analyze this together. We'll take a look at our first version, which is the one that showed up in non-singular linear systems problems. In this case, there are no zero rows, so that one's satisfied trivially. Notice that the column index of the first non-zero entry in a row is larger than the ones before it. Another way to say that is the leading entries go down and to the right. So a leading entry is the first non-zero entry. We saw in the notation from previous lessons, we use stars to represent non-zero. So notice the leading entry in row 1 is in position 1, 1. When we go down to row 2, it's in position 2, 2. The column index there is 2. The column index here is 1. So in row 2, the leading entry has column index 2. In row 1, the leading entry has column index 1. 2 is bigger than 1. That condition is satisfied. 3 is bigger than 2. 3 is also bigger than 1. This leading entry, the first non-zero entry, is in column 3, which is to the right of column 2 and column 1. Another way to say this condition 2 is that the first non-zero entry of rows as we move down is always to the right of one's previous. That's very technical language to say that there's this classic stair-step mechanism, so that when you have a non-zero to start with and you move to the next row, the next non-zero is going to do to the right of that. See that stair-step? It's kind of a reverse stair-step in the sense that I don't think I would ever want to walk down these stairs because I'd fall onto my head on the ground. Last thing is, all entries under a leading entry are zero. So there's a leading entry, check that out, all zero. Leading entry, zero. Leading entry, nothing, we're satisfied. So this matrix is for sure in row echelon form. Let's take a look at another matrix in row echelon form, the sparsity structure. As a friendly reminder, we say that stars mean non-zero, X's could be anything, zero or non-zero, and then zeros are for sure zero. Leading entry in row one is in column one. Leading entry in row 2 is in column 3. 3 is bigger than 1. The column index of the first non-zero entry in row 2 is bigger than the column index of the first non-zero entry in row 1. That's the stair step. This stair is a little bit longer because the pivot position 2 actually ends up to be 0 in column 2 and it's placed in column 3 instead. Same thing over here. Leading entry. This one, we have no zero rows. This one, yes, it's satisfied. Under each leading entry, go ahead and look, all zeros. Now, I had a very astute student once say, hey, these two properties are redundant, and specifically, property 2 implies property 3. I agree with that, but it's useful to remember that one way to check is to look for the staircase, and the other way to check is to look under each leading entry and just make sure everything under those are all zero. Let's take a look at our third example of sparsity structure having to do with row echelon form. Here we see that the first non-zero entry in row 1 is in column 2. The first non-zero entry in row 2 is in column 3. 3 is bigger than 2, satisfies this condition. Same thing, we see that stair-step structure all the way underneath. If we look under each non-zero leading entry, all of those are zero. And check this out, this zero row, which we actually have in this case, is at the bottom. If that zero row was at the top, it would not be in row echelon form. Let's repeat this one more time. When we go to solve linear systems problems with a rectangular matrix, the strategy is we're going to multiply that matrix on the left by a sequence of elementary matrices, shear, transposition, or dilation, so that we can get matrices in this type of structure. So the special form is not square with non-zero diagonals, upper triangular. The special form now is going to be row echelon form. The really interesting thing about that statement is if you started with a non-singular matrix, row echelon form is upper triangular with non-zero diagonals. In other words, the conditions of row echelon form generalize upper triangular with non-zero diagonals. They are a generalization of that approach to algebraic simplification. It's kind of like single variable derivatives get generalized into the gradient. So too, upper triangular with non-zero diagonals gets generalized into row echelon and reduced row echelon forms. In the next video, we'll go ahead and define what reduced row echelon form and compare and contrast those two. See you there.